Welcome to the 7th Yale and US College President Speaker Series event of the academic year. My name is Erica Tronish Shibuya, and I'm a junior studying economics at Yale and US. We're very excited to have with us this evening Mark Tushnet, William Nelson Cromwell Professor of Law at Harvard Law School. Professor Tushnet will address social movements and the United States Constitution. I myself am particularly interested in Professor Tushnet's work on comparative constitutional law. Professor Tushnet's involvement in the landmark Roe v. Wade U.S. Supreme Court decision as clerk for Justice Thurgood Marshall interests me a great deal as well. Let me introduce our host for this evening, founding president and professor of humanities at Yale and U.S. College, Pericles Lewis. President Lewis took office on July 1, 2012. Under his leadership, the college has recruited 100 faculty from leading colleges and universities from around the world, designing an international curriculum that has attracted widespread attention and interest, and enrolled outstanding students from 40 countries on 6 continents. Before taking office, President Lewis served as professor of English and comparative literature at Yale University. An expert on literary modernism, he has authored 3 books on 20th century European literature, all published by Cambridge University Press. Please join me in welcoming President Pericles Lewis.
Thank you, Erica. Welcome, students and friends. Good to see new people here at Yale and US. It's an honor to introduce Professor Mark Tushnet, the William Nelson Cornwell, a professor of law at Harvard Law School. Professor Tushnet is a graduate of Harvard College, and I'm glad to say also has an MA in history from Yale University and a JD from Yale Law School. After law school, Professor Tushnet clerked for one of the great liberal Supreme Court justices of the 20th century, Thurgood Marshall. He's taught at Georgetown as well as Harvard and is well known as a lucid and engaging teacher on complicated matters of constitutional law. Some of you may be considering pursuing legal studies in the United States. If you do so, you're very likely to read Professor Tushnet's legal casebooks, especially the casebook on constitutional law, which he edited along with Michael Seidman, and which is a standard text in courses on the US Constitution. His scholarship touches on matters of race, justice, civil liberties, and the Constitution, and his remarks today will focus on some examples from this scholarship. The general public knows Professor Tushnet best as a commentator on the American Supreme Court, notably in his study of his mentor, Thurgood Marshall, who was the first African-American Supreme Court justice, and more recently in his 2005 book, A Court Divided, The Rehnquist Court and the Future of Constitutional Law. His most recent book, In the Balance, Law and Politics on the Roberts Court, exemplifies his clear and thoughtful accounting of the role of politics in the American judicial system. Neither reducing judicial decisions to simple acts of political partisanship, nor authorizing the view of judges as umpires who merely interpret the law, Professor Tushnet shows that the process of decision-making on the Supreme Court results from a complex interaction among ideology, practical politics, and norms of legal interpretation. He draws on the American tradition of legal realism, which emphasizes the political forces influencing legal interpretation. But he acknowledges that even those justices with whom he himself is not in sympathy are motivated not purely by everyday politics, but by norms about constitutional interpretation, and especially by the internal dynamics of the court itself. He thus takes us well beyond journalistic accounts that try to expose the inner workings of the court, and allows us to understand the underlying logic of the court and its unique place in American law and society. We're very fortunate to have Professor Tushnet with us. Tonight he'll be addressing the subject, social movements and the US Constitution. Please join me in welcoming Professor Mark Tushnet.
Well, thank you, President Lewis, for that very gracious introduction, and thank you all for attending this lecture President Lewis indicated, the topic is social movements in the U.S. Constitution, and I want to say at the outset that a fair number of my examples will be, of course, highly U.S.-centric because of the focus on the U.S. Constitution. But the justification for that is partly my own expertise, but also partly because some of the things that I'll have to say have implications beyond the United States. And framing the discussion in terms of the U.S. Constitution allows me to draw on a quite rich interdisciplinary literature dealing with the U.S. Constitution, a richer literature with respect to that Constitution than exists for other constitutions. And so the hope would be that these other ways of thinking could be transferred or at least brought to bear on constitutional systems other than the U.S., just as an example of the kinds of transfer of thinking. My formulations are all going to be in terms of social movements and the U.S. Constitution, but social movements are merely one example of a set of call them institutions associated with civil society, and civil society institutions take a variety of forms all around the world, and in thinking about how social movements as a sort of subspecies of civil society have affected the U.S. Constitution may help people think about how other civil society institutions could affect constitutional systems outside the United States. In addition, I will be mentioning some specific aspects of U.S. constitutional design or U.S. constitutional structure that play into the way in which social movements affect the U.S. Constitution. Obviously, many of those things will not be the same in other systems, but the idea of thinking about how political structures affect the way social movements or civil society organizations can affect constitutional development, that idea will be transferable once you take into account other institutional design decisions elsewhere. My predicate of the talk is that it's reasonably clear that social movements have affected the U.S. Constitution's development and interpretation. The real problem is to figure out, or to not problem, but the real issue worth exploring is how they have done so. And that's what I'm going to be focusing on in this lecture. I first want to distinguish among three different kinds of groups. I would say civil society groups, but that's not quite right with respect to the third. The three groups are social movements, interest groups, and political parties. Social movements being the primary focus of my talk. Social movements involve, at least in the United States, relatively large numbers of people acting collectively, although in a relatively unorganized manner. So membership in social movements is fluid. There are no membership cards to say, yes, you are a participant in the civil rights movement or in the women's rights movement. You identify yourself as a participant by participating. So membership is fluid. The leadership of the movement is also fluid. Of social movements is also fluid and often self-designated. A person becomes a leader of a social movement by doing things that attract other people to respond to his or her actions. In the literature on social movements, there's often a focus on oppositional tactics such as street demonstrations as compared to participation in elections, although in many systems political parties will also engage in things like these oppositional tactics of street demonstrations. And finally, in defining social movements, There's a combination of self-interest with deep ideological commitments. So the civil rights movement in the United States was aimed at or organized around the idea of achieving civic equality for the African American community. That was in the self-interest of members of the African American community, but also the idea of civic equality had a deep ideological component to which members of the movement were committed. So second, there are interest groups. Organizationally, these are more bureaucratic than social movements. They actually have organizational forms. There's a headquarters you can write to find out what the interest group is pursuing. But more important, immediate material interest plays a larger role with respect to interest groups than with respect to social movements. Again, this is a question of balance. There is material interest at work with respect to social movements, but there's, with interest groups, the role of material interest is relatively larger compared to the role of the ideological commitments. And then finally, there are political parties who have a formal role in elections and governance. And here, at least in the United States, one of the things that matters most about how social movements interact with political parties is that political parties tend to have more comprehensive platforms than social movements or interest groups do. There are sometimes single issue parties. They tend, as I'll mention in a moment, to get absorbed into leading political parties of the time. But mostly political parties are aim to have a comprehensive program. So again, to revert to the example of the civil rights movement, which is the one that I'm most familiar with, the US civil rights movement's leaders didn't really have to have positions on many aspects of US foreign policy. They did have positions on some aspects of US foreign policy, such as in the 1950s, anti-colonialism, but they didn't have to have a position and didn't have a position on nuclear deterrence as a military strategy. The main political parties did have to have such positions. So the comprehensiveness of the platform is one thing that distinguishes political parties from social movements. In addition, usually political parties actually want to win elections in the near future, whereas social movement participants tend to have a longer time horizon. Now, neither of these are absolutes. That is, there are some parties that are political parties that are willing to say we will lose elections for quite a while, but we will win, prevail in the long run. And there are some social movement participants in particular who are impatient about long-term strategies and want to achieve immediate victories. But overall, the time horizons of political parties tend to be shorter than those of social movements. Having distinguished among these three groups, though, I want to make it clear that the boundaries between them are not always sharp. So, for example, there have been in the United States regular alliances between social movements and interest groups. Here, the classic example is the movement in the United States for alcohol prohibition, which was a long-term social movement dating back to before the Civil War, mid-19th century, and achieving success, temporary success, but nonetheless success, in the second decade of the 20th century. So there's a genuine social movement supporting alcohol prohibition. but it also ends up being supported by what's characterized in the literature as an alliance of Baptists and bootleggers, the Baptists being the social movement, the bootleggers being the interest group who saw the possibility of material gain out of operating, not legally, but operating within a system of alcohol prohibition. In addition, again, on this fluid boundaries or unclear boundaries, political parties have sometimes been the creations of interest groups, at least in the 19th century, and I'll explain that qualification in a moment. So before the Civil War in the United States, there was what was known as the anti-Masonic party, which was an anti-immigrant party. There was the Free Soil Party, which was an abolitionist party. And these parties ran candidates and were elected on the local and on the congressional level. Notably, though, both actually were absorbed into the existing major parties. The Free Soil Party became or was absorbed into what became the Republican Party. And here it's worth pausing again for a comparative note. I talk about the major parties in the United States because the U.S. is a system that has two major parties, essentially two major parties at any one time. That's a result of the structure of the U.S. Election system, where there are districted elections, single-member districts, and an election rule that says whoever receives a plurality of the votes in the district becomes the representative for that district. When you think through the logic of that, of the single district plus plurality winner rule, it does push in the direction of having two parties. It's not guaranteed, but it's enough of a generalization that in political science gets labeled Duverger's law. The second point here is that similar processes of absorption of social movements into a political party can and do occur in dominant party systems. The leaders of the mechanisms are obviously different, but what happens is that the leaders of the dominant party observe the existence of the social movement and understand that its existence can pose a political challenge to their dominance, which they want to maintain. And so they do things to either absorb the social movement into the dominant party or do things to manage the social movement in a way that reduces the threat to the party's dominance. The latter example, the best example of the latter is things that happened in South Africa around the turn of this century. I'll come back to the South African example in a moment as well. And then the third example of the boundary problems is that in the United States, social movements actually can be seen sometimes as the product of parties, or at least as the product of parties that are inadequately addressing concerns that turn out to be widespread. Social movements arise when the major parties don't address their concerns. Here, the two clearest examples are the abolitionist movement, abolition of slavery before the Civil War in the United States, and the modern civil rights movement from the 1940s through the 1960s. Both of those movements came into being because the existing political parties were not doing anything, in all practical terms, to satisfy the demands of or the interests of those who were parts of those movements. Now, again, once these movements arise, they can be absorbed into the major parties, as occurred in both examples. The abolitionist movement was absorbed into the then Republican Party, the civil rights movement absorbed into the Democratic Party. But they exist, or they come into being before the parties, and then the parties respond to them. I want to turn now to the mechanisms of influence of social movements on the Constitution, and I have, I think, three or four mechanisms that I want to talk about. The first is direct effects. What I mean by direct effects are amendments, formal amendments to the U.S. Constitution, which are achieved without working through the major political parties. It's a combination of, I guess, formal amendment and the lack of involvement of the major political parties that characterizes what I'm calling direct effects. Parties aren't irrelevant to this, but they are latecomers. So the classic example here is the achievement of woman suffrage by constitutional amendment in the United States. The story overall is rather complicated, but I'll single out a few features of it that have some general significance. First of all, the federal system in the United States meant that women could achieve the suffrage, the vote, in particular states in the United States without having to succeed at the national level all at once. Then having succeeded in one and then several states, they were able to exert political influence through their elected representatives, who are members of the major parties, on the position of the parties. In addition, so federalism was one important structure. In states in the beginning of the 20th century that had referenda, citizen-initiated mechanisms of legislation, women's suffrage was achieved in part on some occasions through referendum, which bypassed the political party, the political parties. A single issue party was created, the National Women's Party. They ran candidates, but obviously didn't succeed given the exclusion of women from the franchise. But they also influenced other political parties, third parties, the Socialist Party being the main one. And the major parties did respond to these concerns about being articulated by third parties. A similar process occurred in connection with alcohol prohibition, but I won't go through the details. I do want to stress, excuse me, the effect of political structure here, federalism and the existence of referenda. Achieving women's suffrage would have been more difficult, would have taken more time in a unitary system where the only mechanism of constitutional change would have been formal action by the U.S. Congress by the U.S. Congress. A second mechanism of influence on the Constitution, of social movement influence on the Constitution, is through the political parties. And here the straightforward version is pretty easy to understand. Party leaders observe a social movement out there, and they see the possibility of what I'll call, for reasons I'll explain in a moment, net political gain by taking on some of the social movement's policy goals. Now, sometimes leaders in both parties see this opportunity, and then there's competition between the parties for adherence from the social movement. Sometimes the leadership of one party is better or more astute at seeing opportunities and seizing them. And here I do want to raise again the example of South Africa as a how this mechanism can work in a dominant party system. In South Africa, the reason I said around the turn of this century is that it was at that period that the dominant party, the African National Congress, had a particularly astute leadership under Nelson Mandela, but a circle of people around him as well, who were able to see the emerging social movements and figure out how to deal with them. The subsequent leadership in South Africa, again, the party remains dominant. The subsequent leadership has been less astute in managing these problems. Now let me return to the US example where we have a two-party system. I've said you have political leaders seeing the social movement and seeing the possibility of political gain, and then there's competition. But sometimes when one party is, leadership of one party is better or more astute than the other, there's a dynamic of polarization. One party becomes the place where the social movement activists find themselves comfortable, the other where the movement's opponents find themselves comfortable. The reason for that dynamic, and not incidental, is the complexity of party platforms, which is one of the reasons I introduced that when I distinguished between political parties and social movements. The complexity of party platforms means that sometimes the social movement's goals will fit better with one rather than the other party platform. So I'll give you two examples, again, from the 20th century. The civil rights movement did have a, in order to accomplish the goals of the civil rights movement, it was almost essential that the national government exert substantial power. At the time the civil rights movement became significant, again in the 1940s and 1950s, the Republican Party had already become committed to an ideology of, relatively speaking, small government. And so it was more difficult to fit the civil rights movement's goals into the ideological framework of the Republican Party. Second example is the modern evangelical movement in the United States, which became a part of the Republican Party coalition. The reason that occurred is, again, that the Republican Party platform had developed from the 1950s on a criticism of judicial activism, which got translated by got absorbed by modern evangelicals into when they became deeply opposed to the Supreme Court's decisions regarding abortion and choice. And so it was easier for evangelicals to see themselves as part of the Republican Party than as part of the Democratic Party, which was, for other reasons, committed to the position of choice with respect to reproduction. Now, it's important to note here that my formulation was about net political advantage. Gaining some adherence from the social movement might mean losing others already in the party. The most famous example here is the relation between the civil rights movement and the Democratic Party in the 1960s. There's a comment that nobody can quite pin down, but everybody seems to believe that it was made by Lyndon Johnson when he signed a civil rights bill. It's not clear what civil rights bill it was. It might have been the 1964 Civil Rights Act or the 1965 Civil Rights Act. But the comment is reported, as reported, is that he said he was doing this, but he knew that it meant losing the South for the Democratic Party for at least a generation. It turns out to have been four or five generations now that's occurred. He nonetheless thought, first of all, he was committed in principle to the ideas of these statutes, but he also thought that net, the Democratic Party would be better off, in, even in the long run, by taking on the adherence of the civil rights movement, even if it meant losing the South for a generation. There are other examples that, for reasons of time, I won't work through. I'll just enumerate them for you, and if you have questions in the comment time, I can address them. The labor movement's relation to the New Deal and the Democratic Party is a complicated one, but eventually the labor movement became a part of the Democratic Party coalition, even though earlier the labor movement had been quite skeptical about the exercise of national power and the way that the Democratic Party turned out to exercise it. Similarly, the Christian right and the Republican Party is an example of how social movements work through accomplished constitutional change through the political parties. But so far, actually, I haven't actually said what the constitutional changes associated with this mechanism are. There's one I want to address, and then I'll turn to a second, which I decided to characterize as the third mechanism. So one of the things that happens when social movements work through political parties is that they produce what have come to be understood in the United States as quasi-constitutional statutes, statutes that are really foundational. They're statutes, but they're as significant normatively as many constitutional provisions, more than many other constitutional provisions. They're significant normatively, and they seem to be quite difficult to abolish or even amend. So the examples here are, again, from the progressive side, the Civil Rights Act, or core environmental legislation. What's interesting about core environmental legislation is that there are modifications, amendments, but it's extremely unlikely that the core commitments of those statutes, the Clean Air Act or the Clean Water Act, are going to be repudiated. On the right, there's a statute called the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which provides that in response to an adverse Supreme Court decision, it's a statute that provides that all legislation on the national level has to be carefully crafted to accommodate the impact that the statute has on religious belief and action. Okay, now another mechanism related to the through the parties mechanism, but I think worth identifying separately, is the effect that social movements have through the courts. The easy version of this one is that social movements affect the Constitution through the courts by the mechanism of judicial nominations. And here it's important to emphasize that the U.S. mechanism of judicial appointment, particularly to the Supreme Court, is expressly and has been for a long time, well, expressly in the Constitution, politicized and has been actually highly political for quite a long time. In other nations where you have commissions choosing high court judges or norms strongly constraining the choice of high court judges, this mechanism would be weaker, I think. Social movements would not be able to accomplish their goals by changing the composition of the court quite as easily as might occur in the United States. What happens in the United States is that nominations and appointments are needed to satisfy the party coalition of the nominating president and well, the nominating president. That means satisfying the constituencies within the party that care about judicial nominations. For Democrats today, that means women's and civil rights issues. For Republicans, it means social conservative issues. So the social movements, again, having influenced the parties, now influence the nomination of judges to the courts. Those judges, once they are in place, will act, I don't want to say responsive to, but they will believe that what the social movements have been advocating are, they will believe that what those things, those programs are good constitutionally grounded programs, and so will interpret the Constitution in a manner compatible with the values of the social movement whose political influence led to their appointments to the courts. Okay, so that's the easy mechanism. But judges have to have cases to do this, and that's another role for social movements. They can support litigation campaigns. The most famous in the United States is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, which engaged in a litigation campaign lasting, depending on how you measure it, from 1925 to 1954, from the mid-1930s to 1954 and thereafter. The image of this is that this was a planned strategy that was laid out early on in the 1920s and 1930s and then implemented step by step through Brown against Board of Education, which held segregation to be unconstitutional. Turns out that that's not an accurate story. The litigation campaign was much more haphazard than planned. There was this image that they were pursuing a plan, but actually they were pursuing cases as they were able to support them. But the important point is that they were pursuing cases. That is, they were generating cases that provided opportunities to the Supreme Court to rule, it turned out, in favor of the social movement. Similar processes occurred equally haphazard in connection with the marriage equality in the United States, where the campaign was actually taken up by entrepreneurial lawyers who were opposed in the initial stages by the leaders of organizations associated with the gay rights movement. There are similar stories about the Christian right and religious activities in schools and the women's rights movement. The generalization of this is that is one that was made by a political scientist named Charles Epp, who had this very insightful idea that successful implementation of a litigation strategy and therefore success by social movements in the way that I'm describing it depended on the existence of what he called a support structure. An organization that was able to generate plaintiffs, support cases, and pursue them through the Supreme Court. Now, there's a problem with the litigation campaign account that leads to another, and in some ways the most important point about the mechanism of change through the courts. The problem is timing. Sometimes timing isn't a problem. What I mean by timing is the natural thing to say is, well, the social movements work on the parties, the party nominates the judges then do what the social movements want. And sometimes that's a mechanism that you can see happening in connection with the NAACP campaign against segregated education, for example. The campaign was occurring, and Roosevelt was nominating progressive judges to the Supreme Court. In detail, it turns out the story's more complicated because Roosevelt was nominating these judges not because of their views on race, but because of their views on national power. But it turned out that there was a modest correlation between views on race and national power, and that was enough for this standard story to make sense. In other circumstances, there really is a timing problem because you have, I call it, judges appointed under the old regime who face litigation campaigns by new social movements, and why should they care about that? The current example in the United States is animal rights litigation. No judge on the Supreme Court was appointed because of the influence of the animal rights movement. So why would they care to rule in favor of animal rights? More pertinently, though, this is the timing problem affects the women's rights movement. The women's rights movement's effects on the Constitution. And the gay rights movement's effects. The Supreme Court justices who created the constitutional law of women's rights were all appointed before the women's movement became politically important and allied with the Democratic Party. Here on the anecdotal level, Justice William Brennan, a famous US constitutional liberal and supporter of women's rights in constitutional law, was extremely uncomfortable in having women as law clerks for him. He was just a man of the old school. He just was not comfortable having them around. Something similar could be said about Justice Marshall, at least with respect to his pre-court history, although not in his case with respect to his law clerks. So you have to think about, well, why were these men who were appointed before the women's rights movement was politically significant, why were they responsive to the interests of the or the concerns of the civil rights of the women's rights movements? Now, some part of it is pure, as President Lewis suggested, pure politics. That is, sometimes some of the justices say, well, I didn't care about these issues when I was nominated, but the party that I was affiliated with, the president, you know, president nominated me, was a Republican. Today's Republican Party cares about this issue, and I will therefore do what today's Republican Party cares about. Sometimes that will occur. But it's not a strong mechanism, and it doesn't account for major examples. Here, the real mechanism is almost certainly indirect. The social movement affects the overall culture, and the justices can't be completely indifferent to what's happening in the culture as a whole. There is some degree of isolation of the justices from the culture as a whole. That's true everywhere in the world. In the United States, the sort of anecdotal examples are that Justice David Souter never had a television. He was on the court from 1991 to 2010, I think. He never had a television in his life. Justices Scalia and Thomas severely limit the newspapers that they read, so they're not widely exposed to what's happening in the culture. But the justices do have personal experiences. The anecdotal example is comes from Chief Justice William Rehnquist, who wrote an important opinion dealing with a case involving parental leave. The result was sort of surprising to many people. The standard story is that he was sympathetic to the idea of parental leave because he saw the difficulties his daughter had as a single mother, and so he was sympathetic to the statute that would have eased her problems. And finally, there's a general cultural effect where ideas associated with the movement start out as seeming weird or extreme, and then they become acceptable, and then they actually seem sensible. And here the two examples are probably, again, from two sides of the political spectrum, gay rights, where, again, a standard story is that the justices were affected by what's described as the Will and Grace effect. Will and Grace is a TV show that had a substantial role for gays in it, a popular TV show indicating that the culture was more accepting of gays. The second is gun rights and the development of what's known in the U.S. as the standard model, which was a combination of interest group activity and social movement. Here the idea or the anecdote here is that Chief Justice Berger, shortly after he left the Supreme Court, and I think it was 1986 or 1987, gave an interview in which he described the idea that the Constitution protected an individual right to own weapons as a fraud. He used the word fraud. He was a conservative Republican. The gun rights movement took off after the Chief Justice retired, and there was an interest group supporting it, the National Rifle Association, and it led to a gun rights movement led to a transformation of common sense. Finally, I want to say a word about the normative dimension of all this. One reason I'm interested in social movements in the Constitution is that I've been associated with a notion in the U.S. called popular constitutionalism, the idea that there's normative value in the views, the deeply held views on fundamental issues of the people at the time they hold them, not just when the U.S. Constitution was made. And what social movements do from a popular constitutionalist point of view is articulate what are as yet, at the moment that they articulate them, unauthorized interpretations of the Constitution. So the abolitionists said that properly interpreted, the Constitution was an anti-slavery document. To standard form lawyers at the time, that was a ridiculous position. But it was a popular constitutionalist position, an unauthorized interpretation of the Constitution. Similarly, with gun rights supporters and the individual rights interpretation, as I've just mentioned, and in something that has not yet occurred in the U.S. The labor movement was, in the 19th and early 20th century, was articulating a constitutional vision of a redistributed social welfare state where wages, employment, and well-being were seen to be constitutional rights. Again, these were unauthorized by standard form reasoning, but they had important normative content and had connections to the views of the people at the time that these views were being articulated. And so are consistent with, so these ideas are consistent with the idea of popular constitutionalism. And that, so again, social movements are one of the ways or one of the forms in which popular constitutionalism might manifest itself. Just to conclude, the role of social movements in constitutional development in the U.S. Is persistent and continuing. You can't understand the Constitution of the U.S. without understanding that role. I think that suitably modified, it's probably true that in many other nations, you have to understand how social movements operate through the mechanisms available in those nations to modify the Constitution in order to understand what the Constitution of those nations are. But certainly with the U.S., you can understand the U.S. Constitution without understanding social movements. I hope to have illuminated that proposition and perhaps more general issues. I thank you for your attention, and I welcome questions and comments that you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I would like to invite President Lewis up on stage for a Q&A session.
Questions, please come up to the mics that are in the aisles. We'd be happy to hear them. You want to go ahead? Go ahead.
My question is general about how political parties interact with social movements. Is it usually, what's that mechanism? Is it usually that the political parties already stand for something and they adopt a social movement, or that they adopt a social movement in order to get votes of that movement?
I think both occur, but the more important one is the second one. Mm-hmm. You have an ambitious politician who sees the possibility of advancing his or her career by signing on to the goals of the social movement. Now, you know, sometimes that calculation will be wrong, and you see candidacies that or bids to become party leaders that fail because they mistakenly thought that the social movement would come along. Maybe something like, I'm not sure this is the perfect, Nelson Rockefeller in the civil rights movement in the Republican Party. He was committed to civil rights, but it turned out that that was not going to provide electoral advantage to the Republicans, and so he failed. Lyndon Johnson is probably the best example of an astute political leader who saw net political gain from this. Now, again, I do want to, the first of your possibilities does occur. There are, the leaders are not always pure political calculators. They have views and values, and they see that the social movement is articulating some views and values consistent more or less with their own, maybe, you know, going too far in some sense, they might think, but they would sign on for that reason.
Thank you.
If I could ask a question following up on your last comments about the way it works in different countries, we talked about the fact that I'm from Canada and here we are living in Singapore. The U.S., if I understand it, is the first country to have a written constitution and a Supreme Court that has the power, which developed in the Federalist period in the early 19th century, the power to interpret it and perhaps to overturn laws and so on. But in the last few generations, many countries have taken on written constitutions and they've given the courts a role in interpreting the constitution. Is it the case that the role of the U.S. Supreme Court is still unique in its power, as it seems to me, in its power within U.S. society to say we're going to set this law aside and to be accepted when it says that, as compared to Canada, South Africa, Israel, any other number of other countries that have Supreme Courts with written constitutions?
There's a phenomenon that was characterized in a book published in the mid-1990s called Global Expansion of Judicial Power. Mm-hmm. I think that was the name of it. And the phenomenon of expanded judicial power is, it only increased since 1996. Mm-hmm. It is true that there's more contest in other countries over that exercises of that power than in the U.S. Mm-hmm. There's more contestation elsewhere than there is in the U.S. It's not absent in the U.S. and in other nations. The idea of judicial supremacy, or that the judges have the last word, is quite powerful. for people who follow the current news, there is an ongoing development in Poland precisely over this issue, and it's not clear how it's going to turn out. So one of the things about one reason I structured my talk in the way I did, to do a fair amount about constitutional social movements and constitutional change before getting to the Supreme Court, was to emphasize that these mechanisms occur, that the Supreme Court is only one of several mechanisms by which social movements can affect the Constitution. Mm-hmm. Having said that, in a nation where the power of judicial review, while established, was less secure than in the United States, that last mechanism that I talked about, achieving constitutional change through the courts, is likely to be less stable or secure. Not impossible, but more difficult mm-hmm. to carry out.
Mm-hmm. And how does that relate to your concept of popular constitutionalism? I mean, other countries perhaps are more open to the idea that the Constitution can be revised by, maybe not by plebiscite, but by legislative action.
That's clearly right. I mean, the implication is clearly correct. That is, I take the implication to be that someone who is interested in popular constitutionalism, as I am, should be less attracted to the idea of judicial, I call it again, supremacy, the judges having the last word. Mm-hmm. There are a variety of ways where you can design systems where the judges still have an important part, but don't have the last word, and those seem to me more compatible with the notion of popular constitutionalism, and popular constitutionalism seems to me a normatively pretty attractive mm-hmm. idea. Mm-hmm. So just to sort of close the loop, in systems where you have a less powerful constitutional court, but active social movements, you're more likely to have popular constitutionalism actually implemented, which seems to me an interesting and, from my point of view, desirable development.
So maybe I could just turn to one specific and very famous case that Erica mentioned in her introduction, which is Roe v. Wade, which, as I think everybody here knows, legalized abortion in the United States. And it seems to me that one of the arguments about Roe v. Wade that you hear is that legislative action might eventually have solved that problem, and that by instead finding a constitutional right to privacy, the court solved a problem in a constitutional way that might have been solved in a political way instead. What's your interpretation of that, and do you want to tell us anything about the history of Roe v. Wade?
So the reference in the introduction comes from, I understand, I've actually never looked at this, but I understand it's on my Wikipedia page, I'll just go through the story from people who haven't looked at the Wikipedia page. When I was law clerk to Justice Marshall in the year that Roe versus Wade was decided, it was argued once and then it was re-argued and decided in the year I was a law clerk. In the process of deciding the case, the opinion was written by Justice Harry Blackmun. He circulated a draft opinion that Justice Marshall found to be too rigid, I guess mm-hmm. is the way I would put it. And he expressed that to me as the law clerk who was in charge of the case in the chambers. And I said, as I recall, that I would try to write something up in the form of a letter to Justice Blackmun, explaining Justice Marshall's concerns as I understood them, as he had expressed them to me. And I did draft that letter. And the justice sent the letter in essentially the same form that I'd written it to Justice Blackmun. And Justice Blackmun's next revision of the opinion was consistent with the letter that Marshall had sent. So the story in Wikipedia says I had a major effect mm-hmm. on the structure of the final opinion. It turns out, as I recalled, and now this has been confirmed by other documentary evidence, Justice Blackmun was hearing much the same thing from other colleagues, Justice Powell and Justice Stewart, mm-hmm. were saying quite similar things to him. And so Marshall's letter, while it was actually, I think, a more formal version of what he was hearing because of the way Marshall interacted with Blackmun, Marshall's letter may have provided a framework for Justice Blackmun to use, but it was not the dispositive causal mm-hmm. effect, mm-hmm. Cause of how the opinion turned out. On the more general political issue, there's of course been an enormous amount of writing on this question about whether Roe was premature in some sense. Justice Ginsburg has argued that it was. Mm-hmm. Most scholars think that at the very least, the political effects would have occurred, if you'd left it to the political process, it would have taken a quite substantial period of time, more than Justice Ginsburg suggests that it would, to accomplish something similar. There probably was some effect, backlash effect, it's referred to in the literature, and that may have produced compromises, a state of the law less favorable in 20, you know, from 1993 than it would have been if you'd let the political process develop over that 20-year period. It's a very complicated story. I have to say that from the popular constitutionalist point of view, the two cases that are the most difficult are Brown against Board of Education and Roe and Wade. The latter, because popular constitutionalists tend to be liberal progressives who agree with the outcome of Roe and Wade. If you didn't agree with that, then it wouldn't be a problematic.
Great, thank you. Yes.
Beltway bandits and think tanks, are they? Would you class them as social movements? And the other question is this, right? How sustainable is executive orders from a constitutional perspective?
I'm sorry,
sustainable is executive orders?
Oh, executive orders, oh, okay.
As a constitutional, yeah. From a constitutional perspective.
Okay, so on the first question, think tanks, there's been a transformation in the United States over the past 20 years, and think tanks now are much more allied with well-defined interest groups than they were before, and therefore more aligned with political parties. They've proliferated, and the few that existed were relatively nonpartisan 30, 40 years ago. It's very hard to find a nonpartisan think tank these days. So I'd say more like interest groups than social movements. On the executive order question, it's become controversial because of some of President Obama's actions. Almost none of his actions are constitutionally even close questions. They're clearly authorized. You can make complicated arguments about some of them, and one or two are extremely problematic. No, one or two relatively minor ones, I have to say. The ones that have attracted most attention are pretty clearly constitutionally okay.
Great. Could the speakers or the questioners introduce themselves too, please?
Sure. My name is Patrick. I'm a first-year student here. In your talk, you commented on how the beliefs of judges on certain social movements and social issues can affect their constitutional interpretive methodologies. I wanted to ask more about that relationship, and specifically, there does seem to be a certain coincidence between justices and their ideological commitments to certain social issues, as well as their constitutional interpretive methodologies. But justices like Scalia and Breyer will go on public and say that they stand by a certain more or less fixed judicial methodology and don't bend to particular political issues. I was wondering if you had any comments on what that relationship does look like today, and if historically it's been different. That is, whether the idea of having justices who behave according to a certain constitutional methodology has always been present historically.
Let me divide that up into a couple of parts. First, it's pretty much always been the case that people are nominated because they have an overall view of the Constitution that's consistent with the view held by the nominating president. That goes back a very long way. Maybe even to the beginning, and has been sustained throughout. So judges, and the judges, the presidents, nominating presidents, are generally right about that. They have this notion, the justices they nominate really do have constitutional visions of a particular sort. That doesn't mean that they have, sorry, that's the first question, first point, that call it constitutional vision has always been part of the process. Second, it is a relatively recent development that the idea that the constitutional vision consists not of what the Constitution should do for the country, but rather how judges should interpret the Constitution. It's relatively recent that the latter has become the notion of what a constitutional vision is. And even there, I think that's essentially a view held only on the Republican side. I don't think Democratic presidents, we had Clinton and Obama making four nominations. I don't think they looked for people with interpretive methods. They did have notions of a substantive vision. Third, with respect to both method visions that are method-driven and visions that are substantive, they are overall visions, and you don't really know, the president certainly doesn't know, and the justice may not know, how that's going to play out in any particular case or with respect to any particular controversy that will arise over the justice's 20 to 30 year career. The justice will know how it plays out with respect to some of the things that have been immediately contentious. Nobody has any doubts about what Justice Scalia or Thomas or Ginsburg or Breyer thought about the issue of choice with respect to abortion. They were on the agenda. Their constitutional visions were shaped by their views about that issue. Genetic manipulation, none of them on the court knows what they think about that. They don't probably even know how they would think about it until the case comes before them. So yes, constitutional vision has mattered. The recent development about focusing on interpretation is a recent development, and then neither of those focuses may be all that important in the long run.
Thanks, and I think one more question.
Hi, my name is Chi Xiang, and I'm a freshman here. Thank you for coming all the way to address us today. So the question I have is regards to the campus social movements in the United States, where there's a strong sort of debate between political correctness versus free speech. Relating to the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, which enshrines free speech, what's your view about this controversy, and how would such a controversy among the students in the United States affect the interpretation of this article in the Constitution in future?
So on the latter, I think the answer is it will affect the. I think the answer has to start by noting that all of the judges are well removed from the campuses. Even Justice Kagan was dean of the Harvard Law School, but that's even now receding into her past. They're not familiar with the campus as it is now. What that means is that what they will think about it will be a part of what I sometimes refer to as the atmospherics of thinking about free expression, not anything particular about these controversies, but more about if we say that the government can regulate tobacco advertising. What message is that going to send about freedom of expression generally? Okay, I could come to several different views about that possibility, but it will operate at that level of generality, not with respect to any specific controversy. There's a footnote here, actually. It's now more than 20 years old. The U.S. Supreme Court has decided, for all practical purposes, one case involving a regulation of hate speech. It was a city ordinance banning a certain kind of hate speech. It's clear that the court held that the ban was unconstitutional under the First Amendment. It's clear that the decision was motivated by the justices' then concern, 23 years ago, or whatever it was, about hate speech codes on campuses and political correctness on campuses. It's hard for me to think that that concern has dissipated over the 23 years, but it's not, so it wouldn't be the current controversy that would shape their thinking. My own view is that many of the controversies are actually quite complicated, where details matter a lot. And reporting, in the 1990s, I wrote an article on the then political correctness controversy, and the reporting on the controversies is terrible, was then terrible. The details were just blurred over in ways that obscured what the real issues were. And so I'm actually reluctant to say anything about any particular controversy because I don't know enough from reading about it to know what it would be.
Thank you.
So perhaps I could ask you one last question that's sort of retrospective. Your answer about Roe v. Wade was quite interesting. And I wondered to what extent I don't know whether clerking for the Supreme Court is a possibility in Singapore, but I wondered to what extent, I'd like to hear more about your experience of clerking for Justice Marshall, and to what extent it shapes your account of what goes on in the court in the several books you've written on that, on that and related subjects.
I don't know about the possibilities here. What I say about my experience in particular is that I was way too young to appreciate what I was learning from Justice Marshall. I sort of have this feeling, I wish I could go back now and with what I know now and clerk for him. Then I'd be much better. He was a remarkable man, and for both a combination of youth and the political circumstances at the time, I absorbed less from him than I could have. What was the other part?
Was just how it has shaped your account of how the court works.
So the one thing I did learned a lot about how the court actually operated on the inside. Now, my knowledge is now, 43 years old. Mm-hmm. My daughter actually clerked for Justice Souter in 2000, I think, year 2000, something like that. But she's very discreet about it, so I don't know.
not a good source for you.
Not a good source. So seeing how the court operated then did shape the way I think about things. I am reasonably confident that things haven't changed all that much, but I can't actually guarantee it. The one sort of concrete thing that I know, two concrete things I know, one is that the workload of the court has been cut in half since the time I was there. The year I was there, the court decided something like 154 cases, and last year they decided somewhere between 75 and 80 cases. It's not clear to me. I think we did pretty good work when we were there. It's not clear to me that cutting the workload has actually improved the quality. Mm-hmm. I think the justices probably think that it has, but I don't know. The other is that the law clerks, actually two things. One, when I was clerking, and for many years before, law clerks had a substantial role in drafting opinions. Mm-hmm. For many years, the justices were reluctant to acknowledge that role. I think now it's widely understood that in every chambers, for a period it was thought that only the sort of slacker judges had their law clerks draft opinions. Now it's widely acknowledged that everybody uses the law clerks to draft, at least initially draft opinions. And that's a, it's a good thing that people understand that now and are willing to acknowledge it. The other thing is that the law clerks, when I was clerking, all worked, all wrote memoranda on petitions for review, specifically for their justice. That no longer occurs, or occurs in eight of the justices participate in what's called a pool, and the law clerk writes a memo for all of the justices. I think that's probably not a good development, but you know, they've lived with that for 20 years. They're more expert on it than I am, so maybe it's okay.
Great, well, fascinating. I'll invite Eric up to finish our evening.
Thank you, Professor Tushnet, and thank you all for coming. I hope you all enjoyed, and I hope to see you all at the next President Speaker Series event. Thank you.
Thank you very much.